Here are key moments in the story of Pick of the Pops from 1961 to 1966. Alan Freeman takes over the show in September 61. David Jacobs returns in September 62. Alan Freeman's back for most of 63. Don Moss presents at the end of 63. Fluff's back for good in 64. Radio Caroline launches on Easter Day 64. At the Sign of the Swinging Cymbal by Brown Fay and his orchestra is replaced in April 1966 by the Cliff Adams composition Quite Beside the Point from the Harry Roberts Sound. Fluff's close friend, manager, producer and mentor from the early days of Radio 1 is Tim Blackmore.
Alan was beginning to think, I'd like something fresher, something newer. And he was having a conversation with the composer and MD, Cliff Adams, who became very famous because of shows like Sing Something Simple with the Cliff Adams Singers. And he said to Cliff, it would be great if somebody could come up with a new tune for me to use as a signature tune on Pick of the Pops. And so Cliff Adams wrote the tune, put together a selection of the top jazzers, the top session men in London. Alan Freeman went to the session himself. I remember him describing it to me. And that was the story, really. It was just out of a conversation between Alan Freeman and the composer Cliff Adams.
Down number 8 this week, My Sharia Moore, Stevie Wonder, Stinger number 7, Viva Bobby Joe, The Equals. Number 6, Chetane Marma Plunom, Jane Birkin and Gaines. We mucked that up, but never mind. Number 5, Too Busy Thinking About My Baby, Marvin Gaye. Up to number 4, Natural Born Doogie, Humble Pie. Up to number 3, Don't Forget to Remember the Bee Gees. And staying at number 2, Bad Moon Rising. Creedence Clearwater Revival. Staying at number 1 on the year 25 from Zagran Evans. Next Sunday at 5. Ta-ra.
As change in the 1960s gathered pace, so did Pick of the Pops, much of which had been scripted in the early days, as was the BBC's way. Fluff's presentation of the show increasingly matched the energy of the records spun for him by studio managers in the control room next to his studio, where slickness depended upon the response to Fluff's cues. With the launch of Radio 1 in 1967, the culture changed as presenters were at the controls themselves, self-opping. New to the BBC in the summer of 1967 was Tony Blackburn, fresh from the North Sea.
When I first joined the light programme, it was actually, for a very brief time, I signalled to somebody to put the music on and you had no control over it at all. So obviously there was a slight gap always and you had to anticipate it. Fluff Freeman really was notorious for not saying a great deal, but the fact that he then started controlling the music himself and going into the studio and actually putting his own material on, that's what speeded the programme up, and I think that's what made the programme much better.
And it's about to go a bomb in the States too, Pop, because what tremendous progress over here. 22, 17, 40, last week number 8, and the Pick of the Pops top 20 this week up to number 4, just outside the top 3, Mr. Leapy Lee and Little Arrows. And in the Pick of the Pops top 3, there for the second week at number 3.
There was no number one for the Casuals and Jessamine, number two in 1968 on Pick of the Pops. Here's a rundown of the main events for Pick of the Pops from 1967 to 1970. The show's extended to an hour and a half in the closing weeks of the light programme. It becomes a two-hour show with the start of Radio 1 and is heard on both Radios 1 and 2 between 5 and 7. The British Market Research Bureau starts computation of the chart in 1969. There's a double of band records in the same top 20 in late 1969 with a single by Max Romeo and Je t'aime, moi non plus by Jane Birkin and Serge Gainsbourg. And former Ladybird Barbara Moore's new arrangement of At the Sign of the Swinging Cymbal by Brass Incorporated is introduced in April 1970. Tim Blackmore, a producer at Radio 1 in 1970, remembers how the original signature tune was restored to the programme with its new arrangement.
Alan had expressed great enthusiasm for the original Brian Fay tune, At the Sign of the Swinging Cymbal. As I remember, it was a producer called Tony Palmer, a man who'd produced some of the Georgie Fame hits in the 60s, and he had a production company called Finito in partnership with another record man called Adrian Rudge, and they proposed putting together a re-recording. They commissioned Barbara Moore to do a much more up-tempo and much punchier version of Sign of the Swinging Cymbal, and that was how the Brass Incorporated version came about. If you compare the two side by side, looking back at the original now, it seems almost sedate with the woodwind sound as opposed to the brass sound. It was a transformation, and the fact that radio programmes today are still using that 1970 Brass Incorporated sound testifies to just how good Barbara Moore's arrangement was.
I was just beginning to be known as an arranger. I got a phone call one day from a large, corpulent gentleman, a darling called Tony Palmer, now deceased, who said, I need two signature tunes doing. I need one composing and arranging for a young gentleman called Terry Wogan, who is an unknown DJ. And he said also, there's a composition, Sign of the Swinging Cymbal, which you might have heard, by Brian Fay, which I need a new arrangement which has a lot more oomph in it, because it was quite a traditional way. He'd written it like a sort of selling carpets in a Turkish market, Brian, a straightish composition. The instructions would have been the same as the instructions given on the Wogan thing, which was you do your theme a bit and then just have a bit of rhythm to give them the chance to get a few nice words in. Instead of ba bam bum 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 bum, you had to do like that. I do remember that I was given that kind of instruction on the Alan Freeman, and that was the commission at the time. Rather lovely. Both recorded on the same day, Chapel Studio in Bond Street in 1970.
Company accepted, there's probably no one more captivated by charts than Paul Gambaccini, who arrived from the States in 1970 to study at Oxford, where he was to hear Alan Freeman for the first time. For Paul, the discovery of fluff was inspirational.
I found it thrilling to hear him do things I'd never heard anyone do before. What fluff was doing was a short verbal from himself, and then the record either was the answer to his question or was the next part of the sentence. So here he was using records as elements of grammar. No one else was doing this. It required a knowledge as well as an imagination, which nobody else seemed to have.
And it's taken 4 weeks, 21, then a 17. Last week a 4, this week a number 2. Box seat for David Ansel Collins in Pick of the Pops and Double Barrel, but they're still kept out by...